It's the biggest tournament Eastern Europe has ever seen. The competition is fierce, so prepare for personalities to clash.
I have no idea what the hell you got over there.
Jubilation from the fortunate. And despair for the not-so. As the world's premier players battle it out for their seat at the EPT Prague final table and the 800,000 euro top prize. Last season, the EPT added Prague to its exclusive collection of first-class destinations, putting Eastern Europe well and truly on the poker map. Well, now we're back in the Czech capital, and we like it so much that this time we've brought the cameras.
Ladies and gentlemen and poker fans from around the globe, welcome to picturesque Prague, one of the most beautiful cities in the world, and this week, host to the EPT. Well, it might be stunning, but it's also freezing out here, so let's get inside and find out what's been happening so far.
Welcome to Prague.
570 players entered this event, the fifth leg of season five, creating a healthy 2.76 million euro prize pool. The top 56 get paid, with first place taking home almost 800,000 euros. By the beginning of day three, the field had shrunk to just 32, all fighting it out for their place at the final table and, of course, the champion's title. One man desperate for his first win is EPT regular Juan Maceres.
I gotta think I can beat anybody, but I gotta play my game, I gotta play my hands, and I just gotta keep playing my game, no worries about the other people.
In fact, we've seen strong Spanish representation at this tournament, including high-stakes cash player and poker coach Raúl Maestra.
There are two or three people who I'm especially worried about. One of them is Juan Maceiras, who is the other Spanish player, Sebastian Rutenberg. It's a very good player. I have saw him playing a couple of times, and I know he's good, solid, and aggressive. It will be very special for me to make a final table today.
Both remaining Spaniards are at our first feature table, and this is the man they're most concerned about.
Today I will play really loose and will gamble it up because my chips are not that great and I tried to make the final table and not just make the money.
Unfortunately, he didn't get off to a great start though, doubling up the tourney short stack Salvatore Bonavena twice in the first nine hands. Sebastian has the medal to come back strong though, so let's get over to the feature table and see how he's getting on.
Sitting alongside me in the analyst chair is someone who writes about poker, commentates on poker, plays poker. It's Vicky Coren. And of those three, Vicky, I'm sure playing is the most fun, but commentating with me has got to come a close second.
Oh, that's right up there in my list of all-time favourite things to do.
Oh, that was a tenner well spent. From this first hand, we see Sebastian Rutenberg raising it up with ace-king. He's made it 13,000.
Yeah, I remember Sebastian Rutenberg from the German team in the Poker Nations Cup. The surprise good results for Germany.
And of course, Rutenberg's having a really good year on the EPT, winning Barcelona. Into the last 32 of this tournament, he's been re-raised here by Juan Maceiras, another EPT regular. He's made it 40,000 with King Queen. A danger hand, Vicky.
Yeah, I think once Rutenberg's raised it with Ace King, he might have to. There we go. He's going to have to move all in now that he's had the re-raise. Some people will limp in with an Ace King, you know, limp and raise because it's no pair. But once he's built the pot that big, he's got to stick it in.
130.
Oh, meanwhile, a player's gone from one of our outer tables. Petr Samchenko.
Sebastian's out in 32nd
place. Are we going to see another elimination here on our feature table as Maceiras has the decision? Rutenberg is the player all in. Started the hand with fewer chips than his opponent.
What do you have? Pair of sevens? Pair of eights?
I don't have eights.
You don't have eights?
I don't have eights.
Close to that.
I'm not sick.
Eh?
Thing is,
what are you saying?
Even if Maceiras' read was correct and he does have sevens or eights, why would you want to flip at this stage in the tournament?
Well, if he's up against seven or eights, then he might take the gamble because he can't get knocked out. He could get a big stack. But Sebastian Ruthenberg is not the kind of person to come raising in early with a pair of sevens or eights and re-raise all in.
As he says, he's not that sick.
Well, did he say he wasn't sick or he wasn't thick? I mean, I don't think he's either. I wasn't sure what he was projecting there.
King, queen.
Look at that smile from Ruthenberg. He's delighted to hear it's the king, queen.
That's sick, eh?
That is very sick.
I'm really thinking about it.
It's interesting that Massieres feels he's in control of the situation. He thinks if he says he's got king queen, he'll get a read that will help him.
Nine's no good.
I would call you with nine. Nines are good. If I can change my card for nines, I call. That's for sure.
Wanna switch then?
This for nines?
No, this. For yours.
And they say Germans have no sense of humor.
I need a ruling.
What a gambler this Massieres. He's really trying to put him on a hand that there's no hand that king queen can beat. He's trying to put him on a hand he might want to race against. Just pass, there's no law against it.
Wow. Alright, nice hand.
Some players, once they put chips in that pot, they do not want to let their hand go. And this guy's one of them.
Hand passes. I've called you with nines, that's for sure.
He lays it down.
Nines is good.
Welcome back to Prague in the fifth leg of the fifth season of the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour. 31 players remain, young, old, hairy, hip, and very talented. Sebastian Ruthenberg is on our feature table.
It's a nine of diamonds and we have a decision.
Last time we saw him, he was being crowned champion of Barcelona in the first leg of this season's tour. Combine that with a 13th, 10th, and a third place finish, and it's easy to see why Ruthenberg is riding high in our EPT TLB rankings. If he wins here in Prague, he'll be hot on Grapelier's heels. Longtime TLB leader Ramviswani is now down in 7th.
What I love about Ruthenberg is his humility. He describes himself as a luck box, and yet clearly he's got a skill at this game. He knows what he's doing.
What do you mean? He was a luck box there. He found someone who wants to re-raise him with King Queen in the first hand.
Salvatore Bonavena, one of the Italian players in the field. Folding, not going to play this hand. Brian Jensen from Denmark.
Look at that squeeze. He was hoping it was ace-queen. But no, it was the four.
Oh, Juan Massieres has found a hand he doesn't want to play. From the USA, this is John Riley. Ace-queen offsuit. So Jensen was looking for the ace-queen. Riley genuinely has it. Looks like he's counting out chips for a raise here.
Well, he's got a raise. He loves it, doesn't he? Because from this position, it'll look like a steal. He's hoping someone will play back out of the blinds.
He's going to raise to 16,000, 11,000 more.
In the big blind is Dan Pedersen, the other Danish player at our feature table.
You see, he's looking sceptical. That's exactly what Riley wants. It's so nice to find a hand in that kind of spot where you'd probably raise anyway. Oh, God, that's really dangerous. He might play back with his bet. He should, really.
Dan's going to make the call.
Well, he's decided just to call. Is that because he's got position?
You can remember your
lines are going to take a look at the flop
because
now.
He hasn't decided yet what Riley's up to, and he wants to see if he'll better get on the flop. But if the ace comes down,
flop is five. Instead, it's a nine high diamonds. Flop. Pedersen moves in front.
Who's the luck box now? You see, even though a lot of people would say that it was very weak of Pedersen to just call before, even if it wasn't a nine on the flop, it's tricky for Riley. He'd much rather get the defensive play pre-flop. Wow!
Man, you're all in machine.
Check raise from Riley, and it's an all-in re-raise, and I do think that Pedersen is considering making the call here. Top pair, top kicker.
What is this? I called.
He has called.
Dan has announced call.
I think he's got a call. I mean, if he's going to call preflop with the ace nine, he can't pass when the nine comes.
Riley knows he's drawing thin. Best hope is a queen or runner on a diamond to make an ace high flush.
King queen good against you.
I'll tell you later, okay?
Oh, Massey Harrison Ruthenberg is still talking about the ace king king queen hand. Give it a rest, guys.
Look at Riley. He's just sickened, sickened by this situation. He really wants a diamond. Or a queen, obviously.
It's got to be a queen. There are three of them in the deck. Riley's standing up because he knows there's just a 7% chance that queen will come, and it doesn't. 31st place finisher, John Riley from Arizona.
Sebastian, good luck, man.
Oh, and he gives his support to Ruthenberg.
He doesn't mean it. He looks around at everyone still in action, and he just wants them all dead.
I want him back.
We'll have a fight later.
We will.
The winners can laugh.
So 30 players remain, and after Riley's exit, we're seven-handed at our feature table. It has a distinctly Spanish feel, with top pros Maestra and Maceras the biggest threats to serial EPT casher Sebastian Ruthenberg. Table 2 features EPT regular Roy van der Locht. This is his first cash. Howard Spear in seat 1 is the tourney short stack. Table 3 features the tourney chip leader Frederik Nygaard in seat 7. Joris Jaspers is a big online name, while Rifat Pelovic is a much feared Swedish pro. Finally, table 4 features Frenchman Ludovic Lacaille. He just final tabled in Warsaw. It's a table dominated by Italians. As we rejoin the action, Massimo De Chico is all in against Xander De Vries.
Yes, Massimo called De Vries' bet with a pocket pair, pocket nines, hoping his opponent had two overcards. Unfortunately, he's up against kings. So De Vries in a position to eliminate Massimo De Chico here. But a nine on the river sees De Chico win the hand and sees the Italian double up through De Vries. Oh, this can be a sick game at times.
So now I guess I only lost 100k since I started today.
Well, back at our feature table, Juan Macieras is still holding court, still going on about that hand with the king queen.
Well, maybe he's embarrassed about it, you know. He didn't need to raise with king queen at that stage. Mind you, speaking of not needing to raise.
Creative play from Sebastian Ruthenberg. Blind still 2,500 and 5,000. He's made it 13k with 10-3 off suit. Here we see pocket fours for Brian Jensen.
Well, it's hard to play pocket fours after a raise.
He's going to pass the wand.
I play with my friend. I want to play with my friend.
One says he's going to play with his friend, and he's going to call the 13,000.
Because we are friends, right?
Right.
Dan passes on the button over to Raul on the small.
Well, this is Raul Maestra, who's another Spaniard. Lives in Valencia. He used to be a student, now describes himself as a professional poker player.
Now the question is, Meister is considering a squeeze here. We can see that he'd absolutely get away with it. Stick it all in and he'd be fine. Yeah, there you go.
The big blind immediately folded by Manuel Bevon from France. Right. Ruthenberg folds that 10-3 and...
I blew away 13,000.
Single one, and Raul is going to take the pot.
And the other Spaniard folds.
Look at that. Well, the 10-3 was always in the dust, but ace-8 was the best hand. Released. Well played by Maestro.
Blinds have gone up. 3,000, 6,000. Every player posting the running ante of 500. Well, last time it was pocket fours for Brian Jensen. This time it's pocket fives, but he's the first player into the pot, so he'll raise the 15,000. Oh dear, he's run into the kings of Manuel Devon. Who will just call? I was going to say, Vicky, if he were to re-raise here, Jensen could get away from the hand, but...
Yeah, what happens if an ace comes on the flop? That's the question. It's possibly one of Jensen's outs in the hand.
And that flop is... Three of hearts, seven of hearts.
Oh, you see, that looks like a good flop for a pair of fives.
Bavon checks with the kings. Oh, he's opened the jaws of that trap, and Jensen is going in head first.
Listen, Jensen's done nothing wrong here. Making the first raise before the flop with fives is questionable, but...
Manuel announces re-raise all-in. Raise all-in, excuse me.
Jensen's might be thinking, is it a flush draw? And also, how much has he put in here? Well, it's going to cost him all of his chips if he wants to continue.
Yeah, he's not priced in. He's not priced in, and it's not good. I think you'd probably rule out the flush draw, wouldn't you? I mean, it might be, but that's so much less likely than that Jensen's hit some kind of pair or he was winning before. Because if he's got a flush draw, what flush draw? You know, ace, queen of hearts, ace, jack of hearts? Wouldn't he re-raise with that kind of hand before the flop? Why call with it out of position? I think Jensen probably knows he's beat now.
There's the face of a confident man. Whereas Jensen looks in pain as he throws away those fives.
Yeah, it felt like a trap. What once the all-in was declared, it suddenly looked a lot like a big hand that had just a trap called before.
For the fives.
Don't tell people!
I'm here with Peter Eastgate, the World Series of Poker main event champion. It's great to have you here with me. Thank you very much. Now, you were playing in this event. How did you go?
I busted up pretty early, like I did last year, so I'm not that satisfied. I didn't play my best game, so I don't know.
Okay.
It's the usual tournament.
Well, who do you think might win it from this point?
I don't know a lot of the players who are left in the tournament, but I know Sebastian Rufenberg. He's always doing pretty good. Then there's a Dane left, Dan Pedersen. He's a very cool guy, so I'm hoping he's doing good as well. And there might be some other unknown Peter Eastgate who can do really good result as well.
Yeah, so. It could be anybody's tournament at this point. Let's see if another unknown might just take it down.
Peter Eastgate is living proof of the poker dream, a relative unknown before winning the WSOP main event this year and becoming the $9 million man.
Can win them all.
Here are some others chasing that dream at this EPT event. Current chip leader Frederick Newgard is primarily a high-stakes live cash player. Formerly a salesman, this man just loves playing cards. Blackjack, five-card stud, whatever he can find, and he is desperate to hold on to that chip lead so he can take down his first major title.
In prestige, it's definitely the highest one, but I'm really hoping for the final table and then see where I'm at right there. So.
One player with the skill to go all the way is Spaniard Raul Maestra, another high-stakes cash player. He's also a poker coach training a team of top Spanish pros. He's played a dozen EPTs, so it would mean the world to make his first final table. Brainiac computer game designer Manuel Bavon from Paris could definitely be a threat. He's a world-class Magic the Gathering player. That's a wizardy card game if you didn't know, and his Buddhist faith keeps his mind clear and focused. So we're down to 25 now as Brian Jensen has just been knocked out and we have two new players at our feature table. Nasra El Nasra in seat one and Frederick Newgard, the chip leader, in seat three.
I'm still waiting for someone to explain to me how you can go from playing Magic the Gathering to poker and how one game suddenly informs your brilliance at the other, but one day.
Well, as far as I know, Magic the Gathering is all about witches and trolls, so, you know, it prepares you for life in the card room. Even if not the actual game.
So one of the new players at our table is Nazir Al-Nazir. He's going to fold here. As will Juan Macieras. Chip leader, Frederick Nugar, 6-3 off suit. On the button, he will fold. So just the blinds left now. Dan Pedersen raising from the small blind with 10 deuce. And in the big blind is Raul Maestra with King 9. He will make the call.
See, this is where we see how unlucky John Riley was earlier. I mean, he raised with Ace Queen. It was a real hand. You see the kind of rubbish that they'll raise with and defend with. Very unfortunate to get knocked out with Ace Queen in the small blind. Yes, once again. the worst hand triumphs after cards. Dan's gonna be first. That is the beauty of poker.
Pedersen with bottom pair and first to act. Throws in 26,500. Maestra has nothing. As we see another player fall, now down to 24. They're dropping so fast.
Yeah, you see, you say Maestra has nothing, but Pedersen doesn't have much. He can't take a raise, can he? Ooh, just calling. Floating. As the youngsters call it.
We're down with the kids. We know all the lingo.
Yeah, that's a blank, unfortunately, there for Maestro if he was going to bluff the turn. If he was hoping to bet a heart or some kind of weird straightening card. Oh, I like this from Pedersen. Gutsy. Bet again. He's got a pair of twos, you know? You think it's easy to flop a pair? See, now if Maestro wants to nick it, he's going to have to put in something like 150,000, which is, you know, it's not fun doing that with King High.
I'm all in.
Wow, wow!
All announces raise, all in.
Well, I don't think either of us expected that.
All in. He's got absolutely no hand. He doesn't care. Millions to be won, EPT title. I'm all in the King High, why not?
Pedersen's going to have to lay this down.
I think he probably is. He can't put Maestro on King 9.
Of course not. One of those situations where we can see he was 80% favourite, but he doesn't know that. He's looking at that board. He's got bottom pair.
Oh, that was beautiful.
Great move from the Spaniard. That's what poker's all about.
Yeah, it was fantastic. I mean, I remember a trembling, shy little fellow Maestro. Now, silent, shades on, all in with King High.
Now, in this hand, we're going to sweat with Sebastian Ruthenberg. We're only going to see Sebastian's hole cards. So we're playing the hand from his perspective as we see him raise to 17,000 with the ace 10. Action has been folded around to his nemesis, Juan Macieras.
He didn't come here to fold, did he, Macieras?
Okay, my friend. So me and you again, eh?
And of course, we're not going to see,
man, you look serious now,
Juan's hand. And it's impossible to put him on a hand. Because it could be anything from A7, A6 to Queen Jack, King 10.
You say that. I might think he's got a real hand this time. Obviously, I'm taking a gamble myself. I might look the fool when he rolls over 7-6, but this sort of discomfort, the hand in the hair, how much is it? I think he's got a proper hand now. At least a pair. You know, because with his weak aces, he was just merrily calling without much thought.
Juan announces re-raise.
Yeah, he's got an actual hand.
40,000 more.
He puts 40,000
on top for a total bet of
57,000. Now, if I were Ruthenberg, I'd throw the ace 10 away.
And he's declared that whatever you do, I am not folding.
As I say, hostage to fortune, but I'm prepared to say that if I were Ruthenberg, I'd throw the ace 10 away, and if it's good, never mind.
So be it. He can't continue in this hand out of position with an ace 10.
It's more Macieras' behaviour. That's not how he acted with the weaker hand earlier.
8-9 spades. Look like that. Your hand, I mean.
Yeah, he's behaving very confidently. And Ruthenberg mucks. So what did Juan have? Ace King.
All right, I'm back, man. Today, I raised four first hands, anybody come over the door.
I lost 100
suddenly he was uncomfortable, he was fidgeting, he was tense, he was staring at Ruthenberg. You know, with the weaker hands, he's more relaxed, happy to gamble.
Welcome back to EPT Prague, where just 22 players remain after two more casualties out on the floor. Next man out takes home €13,800, but nobody wants that. No, all eyes are on the €800,000 top prize and the chance to join an exclusive group of champions.
One of those champions is Vicky Coren, who's sitting alongside me as we continue to watch this feature table. As we play down from 32, and to think that we're already at 22 players. They're not messing about, are they?
Well, you know why? It's because so many of them, they've qualified on the site, they've won their seat cheaply, they're young, aggressive players, they haven't paid a huge amount. They might as well play aggressively, you know? It's the right way to play tournaments anyway.
Raoul Meister has raised with the ace-king. Vivant with the pocket tens will call in position.
I don't really like that call. With the kings earlier, I liked it. He was out of position, he had a very big hand, he was only really gambling against one overcard. Tens? It's a bit weak, unless his plan is to pass if an ace comes. But he doesn't know Maestro's got the ace-king, and against a much wider range, a raise would be correct with tens, a re-raise.
You might have noticed, by the way, that Sebastian Ruthenberg's chair is empty. He has not been eliminated from the tournament. He's merely been moved to another table so we can balance the players left in the tournament.
Well, this is exactly the kind of situation that's awkward for the two tens, you know. There's two overcards there, yet the tens are still winning. You know, if he moves in now, Bevand, it's more in hope than knowledge. I would have re-raised before the flop. He just calls. He doesn't want to make a set of tens.
$24,000 apiece. These guys are going to look at the turn card.
Playing this a little bit too slow.
Turn card is the ace of clubs. Now have queen, jack, eight, ace, rainbow. Raoul is first.
I mean, Meister might consider the possibility that Bevan's called him with.
Raoul's going to check.
You know, a big hand on the flop. It's not supposed to be tens. You know, if he'd have had jacks or queens, obviously, he'd be very comfortable.
The river is the nine of spades.
Maestro might have been just checking to call there, controlling the pot size.
Well, Bavon has made a straight on the river.
Not Maestro's fault, though. I mean, it's very hard to put him on tens for the flop play. I think he's probably got to pay him off. I think he was checking to call, and he's got to pay him off now.
Maestro doesn't like that board. He's got top pair, but
maybe he can pass. He's got to think about what he's beating, you know, not much. Obviously, he's not beating ace, jack, ace, 10, ace, 9. Any of the standard calling hands like king, queen, queen, jack, he's losing to most of them. It's only, you know, if Bavan's just got a pair of queens, then Maestro would be in front, but then why would he want to bet with that on the river? Maybe he can let it go. I think he checked to call, but now he thinks about it, there's nothing he can beat.
So many players would call here out of curiosity, even if they thought they'd lost the hand.
I don't know. What do you want him to have? About a pair of sixes? King Queen is basically the only hand that Maestro can beat, and that's not a hand that Bavan would have bet. He got lucky there, Bavan, because he played that hand a little bit too passively, and he backed into a straight.
He calls for the applause as he rakes in that pot, and Maestro is going to make notes of that.
Easy view to say.
King Queen?
Ace King.
Ace King?
Yeah. That's pretty much the same thing.
More outer table action. Ludovic Lacai is all in with ace eight against Francesco Ciriani with the king queen of hearts. Two hearts on the flop, but Ludovic still out in front with ace high. Then the river card hits, then Francesco Ciriani hits his flush. And Ludovic is eliminated. He, of course, final tabled in Warsaw. He was actually chip leader for the first 2 days of this tournament, but now the dream's over.
With 21 players left, let's take a look at the chip leaders. Frederik Nygaard has been leading the pack all day and still has a hefty lead over Greek player Konstantinos Alexiou. Another notable player is Dan Pedersen in fifth. This is his fourth EPT cash.
And we see the action is on our chip leader. Manuel Bavon has raised it to 20,000. Nygaard's sitting there with sixes in the small blind. This guy's on a tour of Northern Europe, originally from Finland. He then moved to Sweden. Now he lives in Oslo in Norway.
He's going to make the call.
Well, that's what I call variety.
And so will Dan in the big blind.
And Pedersen with sevens is going to come along as well. So the pre-flop raiser and the two blinds. Pedersen out in front at the moment.
We're going to be three-handed to the flop here.
So it's interesting, Bavon doesn't mind raising, he just doesn't like to re-raise. He called with, oh dear.
Four of hearts, ten of hearts.
Trick six is for Nougat.
He's going to check to Dan.
And Pedersen probably thinks it's a good flop for him, just one over card. You know, if Bavon's got two big cards and Nougat's missed it, then the sevens are in perfectly good shape. Though, of course, that's not what's happened. It's Nougat with nuts.
Dan's
going to
bet 37,000.
37,000 goes into the pot. And I think we can expect Monsieur Bavon to get out of the way.
Well, not necessarily. Not necessarily. I mean,
Manuel's going to fall.
All right, but there are people that would raise in his
spot,
discounting Nougat from the hand.
From what we've seen of him before, though, Vicky, he's shown a tendency to be quite a passive player. I couldn't really see him making a move there, especially with Nougat stuck between the two of them.
And stuck is exactly what Pedersen's going to be.
Yes.
Frederick's going to go ahead and make the call.
Yeah, I get. We're quite traditional there, just flat calling with the big hand. Might be tempting to put in a bit of a raise and hope to find Pedersen with a 10 that he wants to defend against the flush. But low, slowly, slowly.
But Vaughan's actually quite lucky that queen came on the turn and not on the flop.
You're very lucky. Probably kicking himself now because he thinks he passed the best hand. Pedersen should switch off. Yeah, that's right. There's something very dangerous about Nougat's check and call and check.
The river is the three of clubs.
He'll be all right, won't he, Nougat? He's got the massive chip lead. He flops trips. No flush comes. What is it, his birthday? No wonder he looks so happy.
How much to bet on the river? That's the question. 141,000 in the pot.
About 100,000, maybe. No point making it small, he'll get paid or he won't.
Frederick's going to bet 62,000.
Yeah. Sometimes I think you're more likely to get paid with a bigger bet. If he wants to represent some sort of busted flush draw, then you're better off betting more. Perhaps he wants Pedersen to raise.
Now, Pedersen is obviously curious, but how curious? Is he willing to put 62,000 in the middle? Yes, he wants
Dan
to see Nougat's hand. He'll show the trip sixes.
Well, either underestimated Nougat or overestimated Pedersen, but I think as it turned out, the small bet, Pedersen just found it irresistible. I would have thought, why so small?
Yeah.
If you're trying to push someone off the pot with worse than a pair of sevens, you'd bet bigger, but no. Pedersen thought, it's too small, I must call it.
Out on the casino floor, it's Chico time once again. Massimo De Chico all in with jacks. Daniel Drescher of Germany's got two over cards, ace, queen. The river is a blank. Massimo De Chico's jacks hold up and he doubles up once again and hugs his friends. What a day this Italian player is having here in Prague.
120,000.
So many Italians playing here in Prague, and to think that a few seasons ago, Italian players were included under the banner Other Nations because there were so few of them. Blinds are up, by the way, 4,000, 8,000. As the action is folded around to Manuel Bavon, the French player's ace 10.
Manuel's going to raise to 20,000, South
Makes it 20,000. Nazir Al Nazir will fold the button. So we have Juan Macieras in the small blind. And he will call out of position with his pair of eights. With queen 5, Frederick Nugar will fold his big blind.
I check, my man.
And Juan Macieras checks in the dark.
You can check it down also. Let's see the turn. Let's see the turn. It's a funny game.
You want to check it down?
Yeah.
I don't think we're allowed to do that. That's my bad.
Yeah, take this money. Of course he wants to check it down. He's got okay, one, small pair. If he flops an 8, he won't want to do that.
So action will be on Bavon now because of Macieras' dark check.
Oh. Let's see who wants to check it down now, shall we? Look at that, 10 there for Bavond. Backdoor nut flush draw.
Free turn card.
Macieras has a lock on the hand.
You said check it down.
We can. We can, man.
Yeah. That was before he made trips.
We're not checking anymore. We're going to bet 32,000. Juan is going to bet 32,000.
All right, I show you, like everybody else.
Take off. Manuel announces call 32,000.
Makes the call. It's funny what you were saying earlier on, Vicky, about how confident Macieras is when he has a strong hand. I wonder if any of the other players are picking up on that. I wonder whether Bavon should smell a rat here.
You know what? I have no idea what the hell you got over there. No idea, man.
This king.
Italian, no idea.
Is a blank.
The truth. This is the truth.
You know, he's got two pair now. He'll probably call a bet on the end if it's the right size.
80.
I call. Juan makes a bet of 80,000.
Yeah, it's an immediate call.
Manuel instantly calls. We've got eights for eight.
Full house for Macieras. And Bavon will muck his ace 10. And celebrations from Juan's girlfriend, Beatrice. Oh, and Juan's fan club also includes his sister Maria.
You got the king, right?
Shouldn't be asking those kind of questions. Get it quietly. Never mind what he had. Mr. Manners, not at home.
On to the next hand. Macieras not going to play this one.
Pass around to Raul in the cutoff.
Folded to the button. Manuel Bavon will look down at 10-6 of diamonds. And he's going to push.
Wow. Oh, well, I guess, yeah, if he only had 100,000. Might as well, oh dear. I know, but Bonavena has not played a hand. As far as I can tell, hasn't played a single hand. So if anybody's going to pass King Jack, it'll be this guy.
Only been playing poker for 2 years and describes his game as tight, funnily enough.
Oh, not sure about rubbing the face miserably. I mean, I can tell you that one of the younger people, it would be an absolute snap call because they would know standard strategy. Bavon's been given the chance to move in with only one player behind. He'd do it with anything. It would be a snap call.
Well, it's funny because Salvatore describes his favourite player as Dario Minieri, whose chips would have been across that line quicker than you could say boo to a goose.
Yeah, because people know that the hand ranges for moving in when you've got the short stack. You know, there's almost no two cards you can rule out. It's a good call, good call.
Nazir Al Nazir gives up his big blind. So Bavon all in and 2-1 underdog.
I mean, technically Bonavena should have raised all in himself just in case the other guy wants to play, but comes to the same.
Manuel is the all-in player, Salvatore hasn't covered.
Good camaraderie as we go to the flop, and Bavon with live cards looking to hit a 10 or a 6 or diamonds to make a flush. Remember, he's the player at risk. He's all in here.
Flop
No, Bonavena put in a large percentage of his chips. He's in pretty bad shape if he loses.
Come on. Make it interesting.
So far, the King Jack of Spades is still in the lead.
Jack of Diamonds.
Let's see the turn card, please. Ooh. Card is the
wow, you don't often see it go blank, 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 and you know, just king high wins it.
10, 8.
Six, a 10, or an 8. Those are the outs for Bavon. Will he hit? Will he double through? Well, those screams are from the Italian supporters in the stands because Salvatore Bonavena has just knocked out Manuel Bavon. He will be the 19th place finisher here in Prague.
It's 10? It's 10. The word was king, king, 10?
King, king, 10, 8, 5. I mean, you have a set or you're bluffing,
Yeah.
And he'll discuss the ace 10 versus 8 hands with Macieras. Poker players, what can you do?
He'll be discussing it in his sleep for about the next 27 years as well.
And Bonavena having a great day, starting the day as the short stack in the tournament, and now nursing a decent number of chips.
Welcome back to Dusky Prague, where the stakes are getting higher by the minute. For the remaining 18 players, the battle for that €800,000 first prize rages on. But making it into the final eight is the first target. They must demonstrate strategy, determination, and commitment before they even dream of putting on the EPT crown.
Blind still 4 and 8,000, running ante of 1,000. Action is on. Salvatore Bonavena. The Italian not going to play this hand. Nazir Al-Nazir has A7 off suit.
Dangerous, because he can't really take a re-raise. His chips are in that awkward medium bracket where he can't bully anybody, but he doesn't want to put in too much. Well, then he's going to get a re-raise, isn't he? Old sunshine over here, he's got enough chips to do whatever he wants. I'm just not a fan of these weak aces when you've got a medium stack. You know, someone re-raises, what do? You can't call. If you raise, you're basically all in committed when you don't have much of a hand. And if you fold, then what's the point of raising in the first place?
Well, he doesn't get re-raised because Nugar will just call on the button and elect to see a flop.
Okay, well, as I say, Nugar's got a lot of chips, so he can vary his play. I mean, I'd have raised, but he's got more options.
Well, it's an overcard to Nugar's jack, so let's see if Nazir can represent here.
Nah, Nugar's fine. Of the overcards that might come, the king is the least likely to be in the original raiser's hand. He's going to bet out... An ace is nasty, but the king, he's got to think, wow, listen, if the guy had ace, king, king, queen, good luck to him. I reckon he'll play this through to the end, this hand. I don't like the call. He should raise. He's got a raise. Why is he calling? What's he calling for? He wants to see the ace of spades come down? Well, he's lucky because it is a blank, but he should raise on the flop, Nugar. See what's happening.
What should Nazir do now? Well... He's going to check. Is he putting the brakes on? Is he giving up?
Well, the way Nugar's played it, it could have been some kind of draw. It could have been a hand that he would have passed. If I was Nazir, I'd probably have bet again. But I would have been wrong because Nugar, I wouldn't put on jacks because jacks he should have raised on the flop.
Well, having checked the turn, it looks like he is going to take a stab at it on the river. Having bluffed the flop.
Well, now he can't bet the river, you see, James, because if he had a hand... he would continuation bet on the turn. Having checked the turn, there's no point betting the river. You know, bet every street if you want to be gutsy, or give up. But you can't do both within the space of the same hand.
The story isn't consistent.
No, now it's an easy call for Nugar. Well, it should be. No point raising now. He should raise on the flop. Once they both check the turn, it should go bet call on the river. Just easy. I think he's just remembered that he forgot to pay the congestion charge the other day because, you know, there's nothing in this hand that should make him uncomfortable. He's got a lot of chips. It's an easy call.
While he's making his decision, we see that Daniel Biro has gone out in 18th place. When we lose another player, we'll be down to 16 and we'll have our final two tables.
Frederick's going to make the call.
Well, of course he's going to make the call. What does he think? The guy had ace four? Pair of fives? Turn your jacks over quicker next time. Next case.
Master shows ace seven for a pair of twos with an ace kicker. And Frederick shows pocket jacks. Frederick's going to take this pot.
I don't think that's applause for Frederick Nugar. I think that's applause for action on one of the outer tables.
Yeah, I will. I only got one hand today. One hand. I'm not going to say when, but I only got one big hand.
Do we have a mute button for Juan Macieras?
I got a very good hand today.
Well, the other Spaniard at our feature table. Well, Maestra is raising a scream from the other tables. It's Igor Regivan, ace king. He's hit his ace on the flop. It's Hans Jensen who's all in with 7-8, picking up a straight draw on the turn. The river is a blank. Regivan eliminates Jens Hansen. So as the action continues here, we know we are down to 16 players. We are going to have a redraw after this hand.
Thank God.
Maestro's probably sorry he raised the sixes now. It's a bit of a weak hand. I think if he thought there was about to be a redraw, he might have mucked it.
Well, he's been called by Nugar in the small blind with ace 10. And Dan Pedersen, who's...
Oh, no, Pedersen can't afford to call. You know, Pedersen's only got, what's he got, 68,000? He can't afford this kind of call.
Dan's going to make the call as well.
He could try to squeeze it. He could stick it in, try and pick up the pot, and good luck to him. He might well win it. Can't afford this.
It's a three-way to the flop.
Pedersen's got to move in now.
Nugar checks. Pedersen moves all in with a straight draw.
And now, you know, Meister probably has to raise over the top. You know, it's the small stacks moved in. He's up and down with the blockers. Meister's got to make the raise.
Meister with the up and down straight draw. And, of course, still the best hand at the moment, the pocket sixes.
Yeah, I think Maestro's got to raise here because he knows Pedersen doesn't need much excuse to put his chips in.
Raul's going to make the call, 47,000. Frederick's going to throw it
just
away.
The call. He's lucky that Nugar gets out the way.
Raul has sixes. And Dan has 9-10.
So Pedersen does have outs.
Pedersen, he played this hand kind of confused, James. He could have tried to stick it in pre-flop, but...
None of the flushes are in play.
You know, the problem was he put in something like, what did he put, like 25,000 out of 70 pre-flop? You can't do that with 10 high.
Sixes are still good. Pedersen looking for a 6 or a 10. One of those hands where Maestro doesn't want to make a set.
Let's see the river card, please.
Is he going to hit? No, he is not. Sixes and eights will win it, and we lose Dan Pedersen. So two eliminations in a row, and we are down to our final 15.
On the plus side for Pedersen, apparently he runs an internet dating business. I'm sure any poker trip is a good chance to meet new customers.
So two players out pretty much at the same time leaves us with 15, and still at the top of the tree is Finland's Frederick Nugard with nearly double the chips of his closest competitor. Strong representation for Italy and Spain in the top eight, while the Germans at the bottom of the table need a double up or two if they're to secure a seat at the final table. Sebastian Ruthenberg in particular will be looking for his second final table in a single EPT season. Right now, though, it is time for a redraw. Join us next time when we'll be playing from 15 down to the final 8. With 4 Italians left in, it is bound to get noisy here in stunning Prague. We'll see you then.